has time to kind of settle in. So imagine that we heard the wonderful prelude in A minor. And Olivia and Anna, you can come light the candles. And we're going to go ahead with some announcements and go ahead and get started this way. We're just going to get started because we can. So welcome to worship here at First Presbyterian Church. I hope that you feel the welcoming spirit of Jesus Christ as we gather together today in his name. The ushers are going to pass out the friendship registers, and I invite you to sign your name and let us know that you are here today. For announcements, this Wednesday is the session meeting at 6:30. It'll be downstairs in Fellowship Hall. If you're on session, your packets are in your boxes, and so you can pick it up today and look at the docket and committee minutes and stuff like that. And then looking ahead, next Sunday is going to be another church picnic. We've had such good luck with those. This time we're going to be at Cave Hollow Park again, back towards the play area where there's a shelter there. It's a lot easier because we can just walk across the flat there for folks that have some difficulty walking. So next Sunday, either pack a picnic lunch and bring it with you or plan to go through your favorite drive-through window, and then we will meet there after church and just hang out together, eat our lunches, and kids can play, you can walk on the trail, whatever works for you. So plan on that. And then the weekend after that is the homecoming parade, and we will be here with coffee and donuts. And so the parade goes by the church. And so I encourage you to bring your folding chair, or, you know, if you have one of those sport chairs or camping chairs, bring that. If you don't have that, we can bring some folding chairs from in here outside. But we'll have donuts together and coffee, and we can gather and watch that parade. Parade starts about 9. So you want to get here a little between 8:30 and 9, so you can drive in and park here, but then come and gather and we'll watch it. It's really fun. And then in 3 Sundays is Halloween, and because it's on a Sunday, we're going to be silly together. So I encourage you to be silly with me. You don't have to have a costume, but if you have a silly hat, or if you have silly glasses or a silly t-shirt or anything silly, let's just dress up and have fun and play Halloween together. I know that the kids are going to have a Halloween party for Sunday school time, and there's going to be a station there to make masks. So grown-ups, if you want to come during Sunday school and make masks, you can do that too. It'll be really fun. And then I had this bag in my chair with a note to read this note during the announcements. It says, "Dear Pastor Heather, October is Pastor Appreciation Month, but we hope you know that we appreciate you every month. This Sunday, we offer you some tools to assist your meditation and relaxation time. Fragrant soap, refreshing lotion, and a mug with the psalmist reminder to be still and know for your tea and coffee." That's actually my favorite verse, so thank you. "Be sure to check in here next week, same time, same station." So thank you, friends. It has definitely been a challenging time in ministry, but I'm so happy to be with this church, and I appreciate that. Now, Susan Seip has an announcement. Susan?
Years ago, when we had babies born to our members, we would put a little cross down here on the table for the mother and father to take home, or the parents, and hang above the baby's crib, or prop it on the dresser, whatever they wanted to do. And then for a long time, we had no babies in this church. And when the babies started coming, we sort of forgot about them, but we have now remembered. So the cross on the table this morning is for Catalina Rose Ortiz, born June 21st. And we invite Christina to take it home for her after the service. I have sent them off to the Zeus babies 2 years too late, and also one to Kristen Province. So we're trying to play catch up. Thank you.
And don't forget, if you are feeling generous, to get a gift card for Christina, since we weren't able to have a baby shower for Catalina. Are there any other announcements this morning? All right. Are we ready now? Andra, are you feeling settled for the choirs leading us into our time of worship with Rain Down? We'll get there. Number 48. Let's begin our worship time.
Please stand if you are able and join me in the call to worship printed in your bulletin. Lord, you have been our dwelling place for all generations. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love. Let us worship God.
Please be seated. God is never far from us, and when trouble is near, God is our help and refuge. Let us confess our sins to God that we might receive mercy. Please join with me in the prayer of confession printed in your bulletin. God of justice and mercy, we confess that we put ourselves first and trust in things that will not last. We desire the evil and scorn the good. We gather up power and wealth and push aside the needy in our way. O Lord, be gracious to us in spite of our great sin. Teach us to love your justice and share in your mercy. Help us to seek the treasure of heavenly life with you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. We do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with us in our weakness, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, we can approach the throne of grace with boldness, and we will receive mercy and find grace in our time of need. In Jesus Christ, we find the forgiveness that we seek. Know in your heart today that you are forgiven, and be at peace. Amen. As we have been forgiven in Jesus Christ, we are called then to forgive each other. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Please turn and share a sign of peace with your neighbors.
Peace to all those online.
Thanks, Jeff. Peace to you.
The audio has really been good, Tom. I'm impressed.
I'm glad. If things are going over the sound system, it sounds pretty good, but the choir and the organ is not as sharp as when Heather is speaking.
It is what it is. You're doing a great job. What it is.
I've had a cold the last couple of weeks. You do not want me to turn on my camera.
Oh, yes. Yes. Two of them. Two doctors behind you. Two of them.
I'll show you a little bit of the beach.
Oh, wow.
Very nice, easy to get to.
Looks like life is tough, Neil.
This condo was Susan's stepmother's, the one that Eileen that died, and we don't know what the family's going to be doing with it. So they good chance they're going to be selling it. So this might be my last hurrah down here. We don't know, but so I'm taking advantage of it while I can and truly, truly enjoying it.
Good idea.
And Susan actually had no objection to my leaving.
Is she usually?
Yeah, she went earlier this summer with Claudia.
Say it again. Oh, that's right. She was there earlier. I knew that.
Yeah, with Claudia. And
are your brothers there with you or some of them?
Not this time. He's doing a whole bunch of concerts in Virginia. He's not able to join me.
Okay. So you're there by yourself?
Yep.
That's okay.
Seeing lots of old friends. Went to chapel service that Eileen used to go to and made touch bases with her old friends there and visited an old friend at the retirement community.
Oh,
I saw Marilyn.
It's children's sermon time. Who here is hungry? Anybody hungry? I have a tasty snack. Okay, I have a special snack for us to have today. It's going to be so good. It's going to be so good. Look what I got. Huh? You don't want any? Why not? Why don't you want any? Doesn't it look good? No. Sam? Chayton, my man, are you hungry? I have a delicious treat. Do it. Yes, yes. Chayton's the man. Chayton, hey, Sam's up for some. Oh, here's going for it. You gonna eat, Chayton, or just hold on to it? It's good, isn't it? Oh, yeah. Taste it. You will like it. It's kind of like popcorn. Do you like popcorn? Yeah, this is kind of like popcorn, but you don't want to try it? Okay. How did you feel when I told you I had an awesome snack, but then I brought out this stuff? Were you disappointed? No? Well, you know what it was. Were you disappointed, Sam?
Yeah.
Once upon a time, the Israelites were wandering in the desert. And they said, we're hungry. And God said, I will send you bread from heaven. Doesn't that sound good? Bread from heaven? Yes. And so they woke up in the morning and they went outside their tent to get bread from heaven. And guess what they saw? Yep, something kind of like that. It was not big loaves of bread. The bread from heaven, I think of the communion loaf that smells so good. It was not that. It was stuff like this. And so they came out and stuff like this was all over the grass. Which I would, if I didn't like our janitor so much, I would throw this on the floor. Gross eating off the grass. Yeah, it was all over the floor. So imagine I spilled this all over the rug and then told you to go pick it up and eat it. That's your bread from heaven. From heaven. And you know what they said when they came out of their tent and saw it? They said, what is it? What is it? Is that what you thought? What is it? And you know what the word for what is it is? It's what?
Rice cakes.
Rice cakes. No. The word for what is it is, yeah, these are rice cakes. The word for what is it is manna. Manna means what is it? They collected it every day, and it's what they ate every day for 40 years. 40 years. Would you like to eat this every day for 40 years? What is it? Sometimes God gives us what we need, but it's not what we want. It's gross. You didn't even taste it. Hey, man, we ate bugs yesterday at the pumpkin patch. Yeah, man, this is pretty good compared to that. What is it? Sometimes God gives us something and it's like not what we thought we were going to get. Do you ever like have something in your Christmas list and then you look under the Christmas tree and you see this box and you think it's the thing you really wanted, but you open it and it's a sweater? Has that ever happened to you? Like, super disappointing, super disappointing. Sometimes we pray for something to happen and we don't quite get it. We get something that's okay. I mean, this is all right. You could just kind of good. Kind of tastes like popcorn. But like, would you rather have this or popcorn? Yeah, popcorn. Try it, dude. That's right. That's right, dude. It's good. We haven't even tried it. Everybody's eating now. Do you like Rice Krispies? Do you ever eat Rice Krispies cereal? No. Do you ever eat popcorn? Just kind of like popcorn. Yeah, see? See, it's kind of good. Turns out it's kind of good. Now it's like real manna. It's just on the ground. Do you want to get it off the ground? Like real manna. Yeah. Change the man. Change the man with the manna. All right, friends. Next time you have rice cakes, think about manna. Would you be happy to eat that for 40 years? Yeah, Chayton's up for it. He's up for it. How about you guys, 40 years of this? Yeah, okay. It's not so bad. You could do 40 days. Yep. Sometimes the stories in the Bible are a little bit different, aren't they?
Yeah.
It's hard to imagine getting this off the grass every morning. I guess there's no grass in the desert, is there? So they got it off the sand. That doesn't make sense. Just one day when you eat that. Yeah, you could do that, couldn't you? I got to think about that some more. How did they get it off the grass? Because that's what it says. But where was the grass? I guess so. All right. How about that manna? Not bad. That's right. Let's say a prayer. God, we thank you for all the blessings you give us, even the ones where we look at it and think, what is it? Thank you for rice cakes and manna. Amen. You want to take it? There you go. Yeah, sure. Give some more to Sam and then you can take it. Enjoy. There, Sam's taking the manna. You want some? Yeah, Olivia wants some. It's good.
I'm glad the children's sermon comes before my scripture reading, because then that gives you a little insight at a child's level of what the scripture is going to say. I'm reading from Exodus chapter 16, verses 1 through 12. It's on page 55 of your pew Bible if you'd like to follow along. Last week, we read about Moses before he'd been called to lead the Israelites out of the promised land. Today's scripture, they've crossed the Red Sea, they're out of Egypt, they're in the desert, as Heather said, and so now we're going to hear about how God takes care of them. The whole congregation of the Israelites set out from Elim, and Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they departed the land of Egypt. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Then the Lord said to Moses, I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way, I will test them whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days. So Moses and Aaron said to the Israelites, in the evening, you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning, you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. For what are we that you complain against us? And Moses said, when the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord. Then Moses said to Aaron, say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining. And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God. Here ends the Old Testament reading.
Thank you.
That was lovely, choir. Thank you. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, as we gather around your word and scripture today, we ask that you would open our minds and hearts and help us to understand the story of the Israelites and the manna and the story of manna in our own lives. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. We continue in Exodus 16. So in the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. This is what the Lord has commanded. Gather as much of it as each of you needs, an omer to a person according to the number of persons, all providing for those in their own tents." The Israelites did so, some gathering more, some less. But when they measured it with an omer, those who gathered much had nothing over, and those who gathered little had no shortage. They gathered as much as each of them needed. And Moses said to them, "Let no one leave any of it over till morning." But they did not listen to Moses. Some left part of it until morning, and it bred worms and became foul. And Moses was angry with them. Morning by morning, they gathered it as much as each needed. But when the sun grew hot, it melted. On the sixth day, they gathered twice as much food, two omers apiece. When all the leaders of the congregation came and told Moses, he said to them, "This is what the Lord has commanded. Tomorrow is a day of solemn rest, a holy Sabbath to the Lord. Bake what you want to bake and boil what you want to boil, and all that is left over put aside to be kept until morning." So they put it aside until morning as Moses commanded them, and it did not become foul, and there were no worms in it. Moses said, "Eat it today, for today is a Sabbath to the Lord. Today you will not find it in the field. 6 days you shall gather it, but on the seventh day, which is a Sabbath, there will be none." On the seventh day, some of the people went out to gather, and they found none. And the Lord said to Moses, "How long will you refuse to keep my commandments and instructions? See, the Lord has given you the Sabbath. Therefore, on the sixth day, he gives you food for 2 days. Each of you stay where you are. Do not leave your place on the seventh day." So the people rested on the seventh day. The house of Israel called it manna. It was like coriander seed, white, and the taste of it was like wafers made with honey. The Israelites ate manna 40 years until they came to a habitable land. They ate manna until they came to the border of the land of Canaan. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So as we follow our readings in the narrative lectionary, we're continuing the story of the people of Israel. Last week, we found Moses minding the sheep and stumbling upon a burning bush. This week, we have hit the fast forward button. Moses has been in conflict with Pharaoh. The Egyptians have suffered the 10 plagues. And finally, the Israelites left captivity via the night of the Passover. When our reading begins, it's been 6 weeks. 6 weeks since they left Egypt. And they've been wandering in the desert. It doesn't take long before the people begin to complain. "We wish we were back in Egypt, where at least we had food." They wonder if perhaps Moses has simply led them out here to die. They have a legitimate concern, right? They are hungry. There is a reason that people don't live out in the desert. No food. No water, no nothing. And it's been 6 weeks. Anything that they took with them when they left Egypt is long gone. I'm sure they are very hungry. And their food crisis leads to a crisis of faith. Many of you might remember Maslow's hierarchy of needs from a basic psychology class that you might have taken at one point or other in your life. The theory goes that if people don't have their basic needs met, food, water, shelter, then their psychological needs like love and belonging cannot be met. So it makes sense that if the Israelites are hungry and facing an unknown future with potentially more hungry days, that their ability to have faith in their God would suffer. God hears the complaints and decides to help out. Technically, it was God's idea to bring them out in the desert in the first place, so as far as I'm concerned, this was a good thing. But of course, God doesn't ever seem to make anything easy. God will offer sustenance, but it will come in the form of a test. First, quails will come in the night, and the people will have a chance to eat meat. And then in the morning, when the dew lifts, little edible flakes will remain on the ground until the warmth of the sun sends them away. The test part comes in the following of directions. There's only to be one omer per person, and you only get enough for the day. Take too much, and it grows worms overnight. On Friday, you collect extra so that on Saturday you can rest and honor the Sabbath. Of course, people are never that good at following directions, are they? Some people collect too much, and theirs gets wormy. Some people try to collect on the Sabbath and they get yelled at. Both God and Moses are frustrated that folks cannot seem to follow directions. And at the end of our reading, the author tells us that the bread from heaven was called manna. It was roughly the look of coriander seed and it tasted a bit like honey. And the Israelites ate the manna every day for 40 years. As a person who does not like leftovers, I have to tell you that that sounds like a nightmare to me. This week when I was thinking about this story, I kept coming back to the name of this food from heaven, manna. And manna is just the way of saying, what is it? Like literally, that's the food is called. What is it? Manna is what the Israelites say when they first see the stuff. What is it? I can just imagine everybody hungry and excited about this bread God is going to send from heaven, only to come out of their tents and find this strange powdery substance on the ground. What is it? One commentator I was reading this week offered a potential answer for what it is, a natural occurrence to explain the presence of manna. Apparently, in the Sinai Peninsula, a type of plant lice punctures the fruit of the tamarisk tree and excretes a substance from this juice, a yellow-white flake or ball. During the warmth of the day, it melts, but congeals when it's cold overnight, and it has a sweet taste. This lice juice is rich in carbohydrates and sugar, and the natives of the region still gather it today, and they use it to make a bread, which they call, drumroll please, manna. What is it indeed? The easy sermon on Exodus 16 is to preach about how wonderful manna is and how God always gives us what we need. And that's all true, but seriously, I don't want to eat manna for 40 years. This week, I was really connecting with what a disappointment and struggle God's blessings sometimes are. Manna was probably awesome that first week, or even the first month. As Caitlin said, you could eat it for a day, But after a while, I am sure the Israelites grew unhappy with it. I am reminded of those times when I try to eat yogurt or spinach, because sometimes I do like it and I know it's good for me, but sometimes when I eat it and I really don't want it, I start to gag. That's how I imagined manna to be for 40 years. In fact, I am not good with a lot of parts of this story. I imagine I would struggle to follow the directions about only taking one day's worth. Like, what if I accidentally slept in and I missed the manna that day? Or what if I got sick and I couldn't go gather it? I'm sure that the people that took too much had a good excuse. Or what if I was sick on Friday and missed that double manna? So I had to go out on Saturday and look for the leftovers. That would make sense. God wants the Israelites to just worry about one day at a time. And I am terrible about that. I am always looking toward tomorrow and the next day and trying to make plans. Living day by day and trusting in God alone is really hard for me. Give us this day our daily bread is not something I am awesome at. I know in my mind that I only ever have this one day in this moment, but I just love to hold on to the illusion of tomorrow and some sort of control in my life. For the Israelites, the manna is a daily reminder that they have no control and they need to rely on God for everything. That would be really hard for me. Back to that word, manna. What is it? How often do we say that when we are offered gifts from God? We say our prayers and we ask for what we want, but we don't get that. We get something else instead. What is it? We get what we need, or we get just enough, or we don't get anything because that's what we need. What is it? Manna? We hardly ever recognize the sustenance and blessing that God puts before us. Just like the eager Israelites on the hunt for fresh baked bread on that first morning, we look out at the manna and think, that wasn't what we were looking for. That wasn't what I wanted. The life of faith is so often like this story about the manna. God gives us weird things sometimes. And we all miss the way things used to be. I can totally relate to the dream of the flesh pots of Egypt. That sounds better than 40 years of lice juice flakes. Things always used to be better in the past, didn't they? Make America great again and all that. One commentator this week said that every church has a back to Egypt committee. Isn't that great? That's so true. We all have people who wish the church was the way it used to be when the Sunday school was full of kids and the pews were packed. Never mind that that was 60 years ago. We still want that now. We look at our church today, especially in the midst of this pandemic, and we say, what is it? How can we be the church like this with this tiny half choir and empty pews? Is this all there is for the future? Is this our manna? Yeah, this is it. For today, at least. Like the Israelites in the desert, God has given us what we need for today. And not only is it enough, it is perfect. And it is a blessing. And the fact that we can't see that points to our own human frailty and sin. If God thinks we need this church to be different, God will help us make that happen. Just like the manna. We just might not know it when we see it. What is it? My friends, I hope that you can recognize the blessings in your life today. I hope that when you receive your manna, even if you ask, What is it that you can know it is a gift from God? So often we don't get what we want. We don't get the flesh pots of Egypt. But we get enough. We get a blessing, and it will carry us through. The Israelites may not have loved the manna, but it kept them alive with full bellies for 40 years. Amen. Please be seated. We come now to our time of prayer and sharing our joys and concerns together as a community. We need to pray for our friends, Bob and Charlotte Gaw. Bob had an infection in his abdomen and it was very, very serious. Had to have emergency surgery. He's back home from the hospital, but it's very frightening. For him and Charlotte. It was very touch and go for a little bit there. So prayers for Bob and his recovery and for Charlotte and Thanksgiving that their kids were here and the church family that's been helping them through. But lots of prayers for Bob and Charlotte. It's really, really a scary week. Other joys or concerns this week, friends? Yeah. Thankful to have visitors. God's blessing on Josie. Others? Yeah, Kara. Prayers for the family of Deanna Edgerton at her death. We've been praying for my neighbor, Steve. Lars saw him come home yesterday with a bunch of oxygen tanks and stuff. So our neighbor that we've been praying for off and on, Steve, has made it home. He's been in the hospital with COVID for 3 months or something. It's been really, really a long time. So prayers of healing for him. Yeah, Don. Prayers for Natalie as she finishes her quarantine. Yeah. Others? Yeah, Dad, from the internet.
This is from Jeff Harper. Prayer for the family of Hazel after Ferguson, who passed away on Friday. Hazel was Diana's aunt. They are traveling this morning to Arkansas for the funeral.
Okay. Prayers for Hazel Ferguson family at her death. Prayers for Andra and Mike. If that's all right. Mike had a fall right before Andra left for church. So prayers that he's doing okay. And recovery from a fall. Others today. Prayers for Joseph and Gail, friends from Journey Home that are both sick. Others? I would ask your prayers for me tomorrow as the saga of my left foot continues and I figure out what manna I am getting for this year. As you know, it looks like I have beat giant cell tumor, but I think there's a complication from the surgery I had last year. And so I'm still not out of the woods yet about not having surgery this fall. So if I have surgery again, that would be the fifth surgery on this foot in 4 years. So we'll see, but prayers for me tomorrow as we find out what is going on in there and what the doctors want to do about it. All right. So if I don't see any other hands, then friends, let us turn our hearts to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Lord, sometimes the troubles of the world seem impossible to address, and the burdens of our lives seem too much for us to bear. Yet we trust that for you all things are possible, and that God alone can save us. Therefore, we are bold to pray, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for peace among the nations, food for the hungry, justice for the poor, and a life of dignity for all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for new life in the church, fresh energy in mission, faithfulness in ministry, and reconciliation in the body of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the welfare of this community, safe streets and homes, good schools and jobs, and the spirit of love among neighbors. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the healing of all who suffer, comfort for the afflicted, hope for the despairing, and strength for those who care for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the joys and concerns of our own family of faith. We pray for Diana Edgerton's family and Hazel Ferguson's family. At the times of their death, we ask that your comforting presence would be with them. We pray that your healing hand would be upon Joseph and Gail, that you would be with Mike, with my neighbor Steve, and with Bob and Charlotte Gaw at this time. We pray for me tomorrow at the doctor, that you would be with me as I receive news of treatment. We give you thanks that Natalie is almost done with her quarantine. We pray that you would be with her as she finishes this time. We thank you for Josie visiting our church family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We continue to pray for those on our prayer list, for Amy and Eleanor as they await a new date for Eleanor's surgery. Prayers for Charlie and Carol, as your healing hand would be upon them. Prayers for Barbara Mayfield's nephew, for courage and strength. Prayers for Margaret Scholl, for healing, and for Michael Allred and Claudia. We remember our friends in Africa. We remember those who have been victims of abuse. We pray for those who are looking for work or for new jobs, We pray for those who are deployed and their families, especially Nick. We pray for those who are first responders and their families. We pray for this good earth, this country, and our church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Now we bring before you, gracious Lord, the silent cares and concerns that weigh heavy in our hearts today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O God, in whom all things are possible, we commend these prayers to you and commit our lives to seek your will. Through Jesus the Christ, the one who has taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts. As we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Members of the mission committee are going to come up now and talk to us a little bit about the results from our survey that we took. I just want to say that it's a real joy to work with the members of this committee. There's a lot of different talents and ideas and a real commitment to mission, and it's been fun. I will say Nathan isn't here today and Jen is not here today, but we found some results. Thank you to Caleb for putting the survey together. We got some good data, and by this time, we had really hoped, as Pastor Heather said, that we'd be returning to Egypt here, but we're not yet. We did have 48 responses, and we're happy about that. There was an affirmation of our mission activities outside the church, but people are seeking more connections within the church, becoming more relational, and so I believe that will be our focus. Pastor Heather intends to organize a spiritual formation team, and it's open to anyone. So Caleb's going to share a few commonalities that we found in the survey.
Okay, so all the short answers that you filled out, if you took the survey, just some of the commonalities, they, all of these, well, we were discussing on Wednesday, are a result of this committee that we want to see formed, but new members and families connected. So a mentor-mentee program was mentioned multiple times, and just building those relationships within the church for older members, newer members, things like that. Faith to everyday life, like applying our faith to what we do, and just fellowship opportunities, like prayer chains and circles outside of Sunday mornings, and just interfaith in general, charitable compassion / community service, and join in promoting activities in the community and just having a presence from our members so people know who we are. And possibly bring in new people to come visit us on Sundays and other times that we do fellowship opportunities. And just education on current issues, especially on the social justice part of the survey, like some of us might need some more education on that stuff. And reaching out to people who haven't been here in a while, just get better about that, so. those are some common things that were mentioned multiple times.
Yeah, I'll just add this, that again, we thank you so much for taking the survey and taking the time to write down different things that you feel about the questions that we ask. And we also want to thank Don Nimmer again for his input and expertise in organizing the survey to make sure that it was a good survey to give out to our congregation.
So you'll be hearing some more from me in the coming months about the spiritual formation team that we're looking to start next year. And it's going to operate really outside of the committee structure of being a Presbyterian church. We're going to try to shed a little bit of what I think is holding us back, which is us need to check all the boxes and do everything the way we used to do it in Egypt, and start thinking about how we might be the church with what we have today. We know that all that we have, our lives and our possessions, comes from God, and we owe God everything. So come then and give, for scripture tells us that in giving we will have treasure in heaven. I invite you to present before the Lord your tithe, your gifts, and your very hearts as Andrew presents a gift of music.
Thank you.
Gracious God, we present these gifts and renew our commitment to leave everything behind and follow you. Give us the courage to fulfill your will so that with everything we do and say, we can become a living offering worthy of being called your disciples. Amen. Let us go out with joy today to love and serve the Lord and be blessed by the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit now and forevermore. And all God's people say, Amen.
Thank you.